was a very difficult time for that city as well. Yet, through the processes and the improvements that they brought about, they were able to build in a systemic change that would not just help solve the immediate crisis, but also help the city improve the quality of life, infrastructure, and well-being in the long run. So, broadly, what I would like to share is that as we look at the challenges around us and as we respond to the immediate issues and problems, it is our collective responsibility as urban managers to think about and eventually bring about systemic changes that will help improve our cities for the future. So, with that, let me introduce our speaker, Srimati Urvashi Prasad. Srimati Prasad is a public policy specialist at the Office of the Vice Chairman at Niti Aayog. Presently, she is part of the core team supporting the work of Government of India's Empowered Group 1 for managing the COVID-19 pandemic in the country. She has extensive experience in health, nutrition, sanitation, gender, and public policy. She holds a BSc in Life Sciences from University of Birmingham, an MPhil in Bioscience Enterprise from the University of Cambridge, and an MSc in Public Health from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. She has published extensively in leading national and international newspapers, journals, and digital platforms. She is a member of the World Economic Forum's Expert Network and an alumnus of the World Economic Forum's Global Shapers Community. May I welcome Srimati Urvashi Prasad. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction and also for inviting me for this. It's a real pleasure to be here. I've known the work of SEP and you know, a lot of it through Professors Dinesh and Meera Mehta. Several years ago, I interacted with them when I was working with Michael and Susan Dell Foundation, which is, of course, focused on urban poverty. And at that time, we were working on urban water sanitation programs in slums. So that's how I really connected with them and learned so much from them. So it's really a pleasure to be back here with them and with all of you. So yes, I think the topic today is, of course, COVID-19 management. But I'll speak, about that and then also move into, as you also said, some of the opportunities for us in a broader sense from the city's perspective, from the health system in cities, all of that. So, because, of course, every crisis is an opportunity as well. So I will talk about the crisis management part and what we've done and what are some of the key elements of that, but then really move into sort of the broader picture and what are the lessons for us going forward. So I think if I start, right at the beginning, this is a virus which is new for all of us, for the world, in fact. It probably started somewhere in China around, it could even be October, November last year. That's sort of the strong information that we have from there. It could even have been earlier. That is something that, is not completely clear. But then, as we know, very rapidly, in just a few weeks, it actually spread all over the world. India had its first confirmed case in Kerala on the 30th of January, 2020. And ever since then, it's really been a huge task to try and contain a virus which is obviously very infectious, which spreads very quickly. And the distinguishing feature of this virus, when we compare it to something like SARS, is that there is a huge amount of possible asymptomatic spread, which means that a lot of people actually have no symptoms. And so they can continue to spread the virus in the community. In the case of SARS, almost immediately you developed a fever, or you develop symptoms, so you quickly sort of isolated yourself. But in the case of COVID, if you don't even have any symptoms, then actually, how do you know that you have to isolate yourself unless you get yourself tested, of course. So that was really the big challenge we were faced with in terms of the characteristics of this virus itself. Also, it acts very differently in different people. You know, if you talk to even people you know who might have got COVID, you will hear very different sort of symptoms. You know, somebody will say we had fever, somebody will say we had throat issues, somebody, you know, has none of these symptoms, but they have some gastrointestinal issues. So it really makes it a very complex sort of entity to be tackling when you don't know how exactly it will behave in people. Although we do know that there are some more high-risk groups, be it the elderly, be it people with comorbid conditions. But, you know, a lot of younger people in India are actually getting this disease. And of course, India has more young people as well. So we are quite different from Europe and the US in that sense. So that's just to sort of a little bit of the context of the virus itself and why it's been so difficult and challenging. What the government actually started off doing right at the outset, and this is the central government, formed 11 empowered groups. So these were really groups of senior, you know, government officials to coordinate the overall response. Because in something like this, we had a lot of things to do. We had to gear up our health infrastructure. We had to train our health personnel because nobody really knew how do you tackle somebody, right? Who comes with a COVID case? How do I treat them? What do I do? What are the standard, you know, sort of treatment protocols? Then we were almost not manufacturing any, you know, personal protective equipment here. We had very few testing laboratories, you know, even things like N95 masks, you know, ventilators, our production was simply not enough. So we had to gear up all of that. We had to get the logistics in place of manufacturing and distributing all these supplies across the country. And very importantly, we had to create awareness. You know, in India, we are not a society which is very used to wearing masks. You know, if I compare to some of the Southeast Asian countries where masks is a very common thing, you know, in fact, when you go out in public transport, etc., you almost often, you know, always wear masks. But that was not true in India. In fact, in Delhi, you know, having lived in Delhi many years, I know that even when the pollution becomes very bad every year, we are very lax with, you know, masks, even though people say, oh, you should wear N95, etc. I hardly see anyone really wearing them. So we had to bring a huge sort of shift in the behaviors of people in a very short span of time that, you know, you have to wear masks, you have to keep distancing to whatever extent you can. You know, as you said, in India, it's not easy to always do physical distancing, especially when you have people living in urban, you know, slums, informal settlements, many other places. You know, distancing is sort of a very, you know, far away kind of concept, not really practically possible. But we had to sort of bring in that sort of notion into people that you do have to try and, you know, keep yourself distanced from others as much as possible because this spreads very quickly. And the whole hand washing, you know, coming from a public health background, it really, you know, something I feel very sad about, that we need a pandemic to teach us about hand washing. It is really one of the most basic things which actually protects you from all kinds of diseases, not just COVID. But it just shows that, you know, we have really been lacking in public health in that sense, that we had to have a pandemic and then we had to tell people the importance of hand washing. So nevertheless, you know, we had to gear up all these different aspects of our response. And that is why these 11 empowered groups were set up. The empowered group that I have directly been involved with is empowered group one. Now, in fact, the 11 groups have now been merged into about 5 or 6 groups as the pandemic has matured. So now it's really 2 groups together where we are looking at the entire evolving situation in states, in districts, because, you know, the situation is continuously changing on a daily basis. You know, you had a state like Kerala, which was doing very well at one point in time, and suddenly Onam happened and, you know, travelers came in from abroad. And now you see Kerala, the cases are spiking like anything. Similarly, Karnataka was doing very well. Bangalore was doing very well at one point in time. But then again, we had a bit of a problem in Bangalore as well. Delhi, we've gone through some real ups and downs in Delhi as well. So it's been a sort of situation which is evolving on a daily basis. And I think that is what we sit here and tackle, that, you know, what is the kind of projections that are coming up, even though these projections are all based on theoretical models, of course, and we don't have any firm, you know, way of saying exactly how many cases will happen in the future. But we do try and use these to make some estimates of how many hospital beds will you require, how much oxygen will be required, how many ventilators will be required. So we sit here, we make these broad plans, we share them with states and districts, actually, because in India, to respond to an epidemic, you know, as a lot of you would appreciate, it's not a one size fits all. You know, it all depends on the local, state and district context, in fact. So we go right down to those levels and discuss, you know, various aspects of how do you contain it, how do you do your testing, how do you do your contact tracing, you know, so all of these different aspects, how do we do awareness now that we have the festival season, we have winter, we have all of that coming up. So that's really sort of the broad government, you know, response efforts. And of course, also a big focus on involving the private sector, on involving civil society. Because I think the government appreciated very early on that, you know, you cannot respond to something like this on your own. You need to involve civil society. You need to work with the private sector, whether it's to ramp up your production of medical supplies, whether it is to reach out to people during the lockdown period. We had a lot of vulnerable populations during the lockdown period. And obviously, the government was not able to reach out to all of these. So I think those are, you know, a lot, some of the elements that we try to look at from the government side. The other, you know, major issue I would tackle here is the lockdown, because I think the lockdown is a topic that generates a lot of questions in terms of, did we need the lockdown? Was the timing of the lockdown right? When should it have been lifted? Do we have to go in for one again? Etc. So I'll just, you know, try to tackle that in the next few minutes. So, you know, the lockdown is not a solution to an epidemic. It is simply a temporary pause button that you press when you feel overwhelmed, when you feel your system might not be able to handle, you know, what lies ahead. And I have to say that, you know, some of the best public health systems in the world have also struggled in the face of this pandemic. So India, of course, has a relatively less developed health system and certainly public health system. Unfortunately, we have been a more cure-focused health system, more of a hospital-based health system. We haven't invested and focused enough on the prevention side. So, you know, with a system like this, you know, suddenly we were in February, March, we didn't know what's going to lie ahead. We didn't know how serious this virus will be. We didn't know how quickly it will spread, how it will affect people. There were too many unknowns for us. So the government actually had little choice at that point, really, but to press this pause button and say, okay, we need to buy time. We need to buy time for the health system, you know, for various other aspects of the response to be geared up. So that was sort of the rationale for the lockdown. Now, of course, in a country like India, you have a lot of price to pay. And I don't think that can be denied. And at least I never, you know, make any attempts to ever deny that it caused so many hardships to so many people. We have a very informal economy. We have so many migrant, you know, workers, etc. So definitely the management of the lockdown itself could perhaps have been much better. So that is definitely, you know, something that I would, you know, put there, out there. But I do think that from a pure health system perspective, we had very little choice. You know, we had very little choice because if we just let our health system sort of say, okay, you cope with it, I think we might have had a much more difficult situation than we have today. Now, of course, a lot of people have developed models to say how many lives did we save, how many cases did we save. But as I say, those are theoretical models and we don't have a counterfactual. So in the absence of a counterfactual, you know, any of that is always going to be sort of your best guesswork, right? I mean, that's what any of these models can be because we don't have a counterfactual to the situation really. So of course, we've done all of that and we do have a sort of sense of some numbers and those have been put out, you know, by the government as well. But I think, you know, I would go less for those numbers, but I would say that just, you know, having been in the health system, I can say that if we had just let it be as it was and we hadn't invested this time in preparing, we might have been in an even sort of worse situation. If I take the example of Sweden, for instance, you know, Sweden decided not to go in for a lockdown. And actually, Sweden has ended up paying a very heavy price, both in terms of lives lost as well as livelihoods. You know, so the reason Sweden said we won't do a lockdown is because we want to keep the economy going. But if you compare what's happened in Sweden with Netherlands, Finland, and Denmark, actually Sweden has fared very badly on COVID compared to its neighboring countries. And it's actually also done quite badly on the economy. So that strategy hasn't necessarily worked. And so I think, you know, we did have to go in for a lockdown from a purely health system response perspective. But yes, its management on the ground in a country like India could obviously have been much, much better. So that's really my sort of perspective on this. But I think what we did during the lockdown, as I said, we really ramped up the number of beds, you know, the isolation beds, the hospital beds, oxygen supported beds, ventilators, you know, as in many parts of the country, we didn't even have ventilators in our hospitals, you know, let alone anything else. So we were really starting from a very, very sort of low baseline here, and we had to build on it very, very quickly. So the health system had to buy that kind of time. But then, as you know, as we've seen that progressively, the decision for lockdowns has been left to states, and states can take a call. If they want to impose any local lockdowns, they can do it. But again, it's been emphasized that, you know, now you want to really disrupt people's lives as less as possible. You've had the time to gear up the health system however much you could in these few months. Of course, you can't address all the long-standing issues of the health system in just a few months when you're faced with a crisis. But whatever you could do, you've done. And now you should try really not to disrupt people's lives as much as possible. So the lockdowns, if any, should be very micro and really should not be anything large scale, so that we again don't have to sort of go into this whole question of lives versus livelihoods. So that is something that really happened as far as the lockdowns are concerned. A lot of people also compare our lockdowns with Europe and say that, you know, maybe the lockdowns in Europe were more effective, whereas our lockdown, you know, perhaps it wasn't the right timing, etc. The only thing I would say there is that in Europe, if you see the numbers, because I've looked at these numbers very carefully, by the time they imposed lockdowns, they had already incurred a fairly heavy burden of cases and deaths. So they had already incurred quite a few deaths by the time they actually decided to lock down. When we decided to lock down, we had very few, you know, at least official sort of cases and deaths. So that was a difference in our timing of when we chose to go in versus when a lot of the European countries chose to go in for the lockdown. Now, exactly how effective, which one was, you know, I think these comparisons are very onerous. Because, you know, we are very different sort of countries, population density, demographics, all of that. The, you know, European countries, of course, have many more sort of elderly population, much more comorbidities coming along with that. Of course, in our case, comorbidities are actually more in a lot of the younger people as well. So it's very different, and it sort of makes for an apples to oranges comparison. So I generally avoid that. But because, you know, a lot of people have questions around it, I think that's the best sort of way of looking at it, that it was very different in terms of timing, in terms of, you know, how it was done, etc. But for us, purely for our context, it was something that we possibly needed because we were just not prepared at that time. So I think that's really to sort of cover a little bit on the lockdown. And now sort of moving forward, of course, we have immediate issues to address. We are working very much on the vaccine. And the research is going on, but we are simultaneously working on the manufacturing and distribution plan because it's probably not going to be rolled out all at once. That's not going to happen. In fact, the World Health Organization has come up with a prioritization framework and we are adapting that to the Indian context. So your health workers, your elderly, your people with comorbidities are going to obviously get a priority, you know, when the vaccine is available. And then, of course, it gradually gets rolled out into the rest of the population. So that plan and all of those sort of logistical mechanisms are being worked out. It will be a huge task. It will be a huge task for us because our immunization system is primarily sort of maternal and child health immunization. It's really geared up for that. And now we're talking about, you know, vaccinating an entire population or, you know, at least very large numbers. So of course, it's going to be challenging. But we are sort of working on whatever best resources that we have at this point and seeing how we can, you know, make a plan around that. The other aspect, of course, of this has been the center-state sort of coordination and relationships. And I think in many cases, those have worked very well. A lot of states have come up with very good innovations. And I think Mr. Bhatt highlighted these as well right at the outset, that, you know, some place like Dharavi had had so many good sort of local practices that they came up with, which worked for them. Various states, you know, Kerala, as I said, in the first round, in the first wave, Kerala did a very, very good job, in fact. But of course, then unfortunately, they got a large burden of cases now. So again, they are sort of having to battle that situation. But they did very, very well in the first sort of wave. Punjab did very well the first time round. And of course, they had a very big second wave. And I think that's the message that this virus gives, that, you know, it's not over till it's over. You know, every time you think that, okay, I've contained it, it's fine, you know, you can suddenly see it coming back up. And so you really cannot ever let your guard down. So I think, but a lot of good practices have come out, right from medical waste management in cities, to awareness creation, to, you know, so many things. And we are actually at Niti Aayog documenting some of these practices. You know, we're not really calling them good practices or best practices, because we don't have a way to evaluate that at this point in time. But they are certainly, you know, innovations or practices that the states and districts have come up with, which are worth sharing in case, you know, they are useful for others as well, and they can be adapted. So we are actually in the process of coming out with a compendium, covering the, you know, the various states and districts and union territories. So I think that's been a very important part of this, and this is highlighted to us that we do need more of this sort of center state coordination to happen on an ongoing basis. You know, this is not something that just when we have a crisis, but actually in a subject like healthcare, which is, you know, largely still a state subject. But the center does have a big role to play in certain areas. We always need this sort of coordination to work for us. So I think that is where I would move into sort of the broader sort of opportunity areas. And, you know, especially with the urban health system. And now, of course, this pandemic, as we know world over, actually, it's been largely a phenomenon of our cities. And of course, you know, perhaps the population density is a factor there. Given that it allows for more easy spread, more easy person-to-person spread. And that's true actually for a lot of diseases. I've worked in tuberculosis for many years. And in our urban slums, you know, we often have a high burden of tuberculosis because, again, you know, it can spread quite easily. If it's respiratory sort of tuberculosis of the lungs, it can spread quite easily from person to person in a congested sort of space or poorly ventilated, poorly lit, etc., which is unfortunately what a lot of our sort of urban slum settlements in particular have to face those conditions. So I think it gives us an opportunity to think about the urban health system. The government health system up till now has been very largely geared up for the rural areas, whether it's our, you know, how your whole primary healthcare works or any other aspect. It was all designed for rural areas, and then sort of we tried to sort of juxtapose it for urban areas, but that doesn't really work. And so actually, again, at Niti Aayog, we have been trying to work on urban health and nutrition models specifically, that, you know, how do we, what is the structure that you need in an urban area? Because, you know, I've also worked in urban slums. In fact, I worked for several years, you know, for urban poor families. And I used to see that the dynamics are often very different. You know, from what you have in a rural area, you can have migratory populations, you can have people who don't even know their neighbors necessarily. So a lot of the models that you actually apply in a rural setting, where you're assuming a panchayat, you're assuming a village leader, etc., often don't fit, you know, exactly into an urban setting. So we have to develop, you know, more customized models for the urban setting. And a lot of work is happening on that. But I hope that it will get sort of accelerated now that we have had this situation, and it has sort of highlighted to everybody just how vulnerable our cities are from a health perspective as well. But of course, it also brings in the focus on sanitation, on drinking water, because it's all very interlinked. You know, the problem with so the government setup at times is that, you know, we work in silos, you know, so the health department will just work on health, will not really sort of intersect with water sanitation, will not intersect with, you know, anybody who looks at the environment. So we are constantly having these issues. And actually, that is why we've been recommending that there should be a single focal point for public health, especially in urban areas and cities, which can actually bring together all of this, you know, because in cities, when you're talking of public health, you're talking of environment, you're talking of water, sanitation, nutrition, and of course, health, you know, in that sense. So all of this needs to come together. Gender, you know, we often forget that part, but I think that's a very important part. And women have actually had to bear a disproportionate burden in many cases of even this situation. So how do we bring in gender into all of this? So we've really been advocating that we need a single focal point even within the government, which is empowered enough, you know, to coordinate with everybody else. Because, you know, otherwise, every time it's like, you know, this is not my job, this is the sanitation department's job, or this, you know, pollution is environment's job. So me as the health department, it's not, you know, it doesn't come in my purview. So we're constantly running into that bottleneck. So we need to fundamentally address this from a policy perspective. And I really hope that with this, you know, we will get a fillip to some of these things. We're also trying to work on a public health charter. As I said, we have been a very hospital-focused health system. We only talk of medical doctors. We don't talk of enough of nurses. We don't talk enough of nurse practitioners. We don't talk enough about, you know, other cadres, right? Your allied health professionals and others. So we are actually trying to now work on a public health charter with states. And again, that will be structured a little differently in rural versus urban areas. But the basic idea is that you perform a lot of those key public health functions. If we look at China, China actually invested a lot in public health after SARS. And some of the dividends that they have reaped, even in this case, are because of that investment. Of course, with China also, we are always questioning that, is the data right? Are they giving us the right numbers or not? But nevertheless, I think they have done a reasonably good job, considering that they were the epicenter in a sense. And that is probably because of the very long-term investments that they have made in public health. And I think that's really the point about public health, right? That you cannot expect a country to be pandemic ready in 4 months or 5 months or 6 months. You have to invest in public health every single day. And only then, when you are faced with a crisis, can you actually quickly sort of gear up your response. So I think I really hope that at our highest levels, you know, political levels, government levels, at least this will be a takeaway, that we need to not just invest in health, but we need to invest in public health, because just setting up another hospital is not investing in health, as far as I'm concerned. You know, you have to invest in public health. You have to invest in health promotion, prevention, because we are too large a population. We can't put everybody, you know, and we've seen that with COVID also. Our hospitals, even in Delhi, get flooded so quickly, you know, with people. It's just not viable. So that is something that I hope will be a big takeaway for everybody, that we have to invest in our public health systems and link, you know, public health with nutrition, with sanitation, with gender, water, environment, all of these. You know, in cities, it is so closely interlinked that we can't focus on one and not focus on the other. So I think that is a big opportunity area for us for the future to really work on, to develop and see, you know, what are the good models, what might some of the cities around the world have done, you know, which might have worked, which could be customized for us. Of course, our context is very different, but nevertheless, there are always lessons that, you know, we can apply from different contexts and see, you know, what might work here. So I think that's one big part that has opened up for us as an opportunity. The other is technology, of course. I think, as you mentioned, that, you know, UNICEF also went online very quickly. And, you know, we are seeing technology use now going up in a big way in all sectors, you know. So in health, in all the related sectors, the sort of barriers to adoption of technology or the hesitation a lot of people had has started to go down. And that's, of course, again, a huge opportunity area. Of course, we are looking at some very, you know, good technology solutions right now in the government in terms of the healthcare, the telemedicine. I've been involved with developing an application actually recently, which has provided, you know, large number of telemedicine consultations during this period. But telemedicine is just the tip of the iceberg. I think we can do so much more when it comes to use of technology. In planning our health system, and especially, you know, I think in cities and how the intersection with all the other areas, I think technology has a huge role to play there. So I think we are just scratching the surface of that, and I see huge opportunities, you know, in that area as well for you know, obviously people in different fields to come together and work with the government as well, be it the private sector, be it, you know, academics, universities, you know, NGOs, everybody really. I think technology is one of those big opportunity areas for us. And I think the other one is, you know, the other sort of third one I would say is on the behaviors itself on public health. I think we should now not lose this momentum that we have gathered because of this. You know, I have seen in many areas that, you know, people have started to become more conscious. Yes, you know, that sort of comes and goes because, you know, this is not a habit for us. We have to remember that, you know, some things have to become habits and only then they will stick. But, you know, at least whatever amount of, you know, use of masks I see or hand washing, it sort of gives me that window of hope, really, to say that we should build on it more. Whether it's in our schools, in other places, you know, use different platforms to say, look, you know, now you learned this behavior during COVID. Now don't reverse it, you know, because you need it all the time. You know, these are behaviors we need to practice all the time. So I think that's another opportunity that that we have. Whatever momentum has sort of come up during this time to sort of capitalize on that and take it forward in terms of general population sort of behaviors as well. And then I think just thinking about, you know, design in terms of our cities, in terms of our public transport, you know, all of this, I think, needs a sort of a rethinking because, you know, pandemics are here to stay, unfortunately. You know, this is not going to be the only one. We are in a very interconnected world, you know, we are traveling all the time, there's sort of free movement of goods and people. So although now we have faced this situation after many years, now it might be much more common, you know, and maybe a few years down the line, we might be faced with something again like this. So how do we think of our cities? How do we think of making public transport safer, perhaps from this perspective? Or our places of gatherings, you know, where we normally have mass gatherings. Is there anything we can do to make those, you know, you can't make them pandemic proof, of course, but a bit safer, you know, a bit safer. What can we do to sort of facilitate that based on whatever we have learned so far? Our offices, you know, we previously, I think in offices, never thought of this. And now suddenly even in government offices, I find that at least we are giving some thought to this, you know, that, you know, how should people be sitting, what should be the layout of those offices. So I think it's a real opportunity here as well, because we might be facing a lot more of this in the future, you know, given our density, given our sheer numbers in our cities, and numbers in our cities are only going up, you know, and they're only expanding. So this is a very real threat for us, you know, all the time. So I think that's another area that, you know, we can really sort of look at and think about more systematically. So, yes, I think I've spoken a lot. So I will sort of pause here and, you know, would be happy to discuss and take up questions. You know, I think that might be better going forward from here.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a great session. So as I have asked everyone to drop their questions on the chat box, and we already have some questions, so I will be asking them, and ma'am, you can so starting with we have a question from Sopnika. She says, what were the challenges faced during the implementation of the management plan?
Right. So yes, I mean, plethora of challenges, but I'll highlight just a few that I touched upon briefly earlier as well. I think one, the biggest was our human resource capacity at every level, you know, whether it was our policy level, whether it was our public health people, our grassroots frontline workers, health workers, our clinicians, you know, even doctors, specialists, you know, everyone was perplexed. So what are we dealing with? What is this? You know, what do we do with this? So that was, I would say, you know, one of our biggest issues. And partly this is because it's a new virus, but partly it's our long-standing issues of not investing enough in health human resource capacity. You know, and in fact, recently you would have seen that we've had a lot of reforms in education, medical education, Indian systems of education. Let's hope that those get implemented well. I was actually part of drafting those bills. So I've seen it very closely. But of course, I'm always very fearful. I don't want the National Medical Commission to become another Medical Council of India. So I sort of, yeah, I live in that fear as well all the time. But more than just doctors and specialists, I would really want us to develop a cadre of nurse practitioners, of, you know, strengthen our ASHA workers, our ANMs, you know, how we compensate them, their welfare. You know, we don't really look at that, right? Our promotions for nurses, we don't look at these things, you know, and our when I was in the UK, because, you know, for all my education, I was in the UK, and the national health system is full of nurses from India. And I used to just say, you know, why can we not give good career options to our nurses here back home where we really need them? We desperately need them. So we need to think of a lot of these things. And this was actually our biggest challenge when we were trying to implement this plan, you know, because it's easy to build infrastructure. It's not easy, but it's easier, right? So a lot of people say, why does it take so much time to build an ICU? Why can't you get an oxygen supported bed quickly? We can. You know, there's no issue in getting that bed. There's no issue in building that brick and mortar structure. Who will operate it? Who will operate a high flow nasal cannula? You know, if you don't know how much oxygen I have to give the patient, how am I going to operate it? Right. So that was the struggle that we really had in this. And again, as I said, partly we tried to address it in this time, but we cannot really address it in its entirety if we don't invest in it on a daily basis. So I think that was by far human resource capacity, by far our biggest challenge, but also then the center-state coordination. We are a very large country, we are a federal structure. There's so many dynamics, you know, so much politics comes into it, as you know, all of you would appreciate. So that was a big challenge as well. You know, so how do you get a country as big and diverse as this to work together? And to work as one unit. And I think then finally the behavior change was a huge issue, you know, to get people to accept that it's something serious. And as I say, now I see some of that behavior slipping back again. You know, a lot of people are like, it's okay, it's here to stay, we have to live with it, which is fine. I mean, of course, you have to carry on with your life, but you can't slip back, you know, into sort of neglecting those important hygiene behaviors. So I think these are some of our sort of biggest challenges that we faced in implementing this.
Right. Thank you so much. We have another question from Shantanu. How were the need of ventilators or PPE or other health equipments predicted or planned? And what all factors were considered to plan the distribution of these equipments to different areas?
Yeah, so, you know, it was based on, of course, as I said, we looked at, we built estimates for how many cases we are expecting. So based on, you know, in March, we started building these estimates. So whatever we had up till then, and using certain projections going forward. Now, of course, the projections have become much better informed over time. When we started off in March, we were sort of almost shooting in the dark, you can say. But, you know, over time, our projections are now much better informed. In fact, now we have also started factoring in mass gatherings. We have started factoring in festivals into our projections. So, you know, how much do we expect cases to go up? That was really our first question. And then sort of looking at how the disease plays out, you know, because around 70-80% of the cases would be asymptomatic or would be very mildly symptomatic. So, you know, these are people you can keep at home or at most you need to keep them in an isolation center. So we came up with estimates for the COVID care centers accordingly. These are people who would not require oxygen or anything like that, but they would just need to be isolated. So home isolation, again, in India is very difficult. You know, I say home isolation in India is a luxury because so many people are living in, you know, one small room, you have five people living, how do you do home isolation? So we had to build these COVID care centers. Then the second level was the people who actually need some oxygen support or, you know, who need a little more advanced care. So these were about 10 to 15% of the total cases that usually need a little more advanced care. So we had the dedicated health centers for these where you actually have oxygen support, you have some doctors, nurses, etc. And then finally, the people with severe symptoms who would need the dedicated COVID hospitals would be around 5%. Of your total numbers. And these are sort of ballpark numbers. We have, of course, come up with more specific numbers, you know, based on what we see in particular states and districts, etc. But sort of ballpark numbers to give you a sense. Now, even this 5%, 4% would need sort of non-invasive ventilation. And about 1% would need invasive ventilation. So that is how then we came up with those estimates as well of how many ventilators would we need, how many would we need on oxygen support. So those kinds of things. So that's how the estimates were built, and we keep revising them. In fact, we revise these estimates every few weeks as the situation is changing, you know, because earlier, say for Kerala, we might have estimated lower numbers, right? But now Kerala cases have gone up. So now we need to revise our estimates over there. And also different states have different models. So like Kerala almost doesn't practice home isolation at all. They prefer to bring people to hospital straight away. So then we have to factor in a slightly different approach. In some states, your home isolation percentage is very high, like Andhra Pradesh. You know, Andhra Pradesh, a lot of people were in home isolation. So we had to factor that in differently. So we build it based on these sort of estimates, and then we keep revising based on whatever is the situation on the ground. So that's how we sort of estimate our requirement for all these, equipment and all of this. But in general, I would say we have ramped up a lot on production of these. And, I think that is our main challenge, again, is not actual availability, but the distribution. So it's not that you don't have a PPE kit, but getting that PPE kit to the poorest, village hospital in Bihar or in Jharkhand, again, that's your challenge, really. So that's the challenge that I think in India we often face, that we have enough of something, but we are necessarily, struggling with the distribution part. And so I think that's our current sort of biggest priority.
Thank you, ma'am. We have another question from Karanbir. If we talk about unlocking during this pandemic, at some point of time in future, people will start migrating to different cities for work like they used to before lockdown. Do you think the government should come up with COVID index for cities, which focuses on evaluating the extent of spread of virus versus the healthcare availability of the vaccine, to make people aware about whether they should migrate to that city or not?
We have certain, it's not necessarily an index, but a certain approaches for looking at which cities are more vulnerable. And we've tried to look at a few different metrics in this, right? So in terms of population size, density, availability of infrastructure, generally what's the profile of people, sort of the socioeconomic profile, all of that. So we have tried to do, but as I said, these are not very, I wouldn't say that these are very definitive things, because these are all, a little bit of estimation and a little bit of assumptions, which is fine. I mean, which is what you have to do in this situation. But I think, it's not really about, I think it's hard to say which city is less or more vulnerable in that sense. You can say it, as I said, based on some of these, but in general, I think in general, our cities, and not just our metros, but even our tier two, a tier three, because progressively what we have found is that the infection has started spreading into tier two, tier three. We started with your big metros. We started with your Delhi and, Mumbai and Chennai. Then the next level of spread was to cities in their periphery, right? So in Chennai, it spread to Chengalpattu. In Delhi, it spread to some of the NCR regions, got affected. And similarly in Mumbai, we had areas around Mumbai, Thane and Palghar, and then now beyond that, it's just spread more and more, right? So now it's really kind of quite diffuse. So I think it's in any city really is quite vulnerable at this point. I think our rural areas are also, but yes, perhaps a bit less because of the natural distancing to some extent. there's some amount of natural distancing over there. So I think that does help some of our rural areas, although of course they are also vulnerable. But I think on cities, I would say that every city at this point still remains vulnerable, whether it's a large one, a tier two, a tier three. But it's inevitable. People have to work. People have to carry on with their livelihoods. So I think all of that, of course, has to continue. But that can only continue if we keep up our public health and hygiene behaviors, and if the system remains geared up. This is something I keep saying, that some places the system is starting to relax a little bit. And I think the system needs to again, gear up, because we might well see that spike in cases again. So yes, I think that's all we can really keep in mind. I wouldn't really say that we can stop people from moving or, working, livelihoods. I think all of that obviously has to continue. But we just have to keep our guard up.
Yes, definitely. We have another question from Jash Goswami. He asks, We have witnessed this historically in humankind encountered public health emergencies such as Great Spanish Flu, but humans forget it over the period of time. Which steps are being undertaken by Niti Aayog to preserve the learning and just simplify, not forget it? Everyone is speculating the end of this pandemic. What is Niti Aayog's perception on the end of this pandemic?
Well, so in terms of learnings, yes, I think, as I also mentioned, you know, we are documenting, of course, some immediate learnings from what has been in the response and what have we learned from states, districts, sort of organic innovation. Because I think often what happens is we look overseas for good practices. You know, we say that happened in, you know, Europe or that happened in US or wherever, right? I mean, wherever, US, of course, is, I think, a terrible example of a health system. But, you know, in other places, we do look for examples, right? But I think India, you know, India is a source of so much innovation that we often ignore that. And the problem in a large country like India is that one state doesn't know what the other is doing. One district doesn't know what the other is doing. So yes, we do. And we are trying to consciously put together all those lessons. But I think the biggest learnings, as I said, are at a very high level. And that really, I hope that our sort of decision makers, our political leaders will take those away from this, that, you know, you need to invest in public health. The suggestions have been there for a long time. We've all been giving these recommendations of a public health focal point, a public health cadre, nurse practitioner cadre. We've all been giving these, you know, sort of suggestions. And some things have happened. I wouldn't say that nothing has happened. Things have happened. But really investing in public health, you know, both in terms of money as well as in terms of your human resource capacity, I think that's really the one big headline that I really hope and, you know, that we will take away from this, you know, as a system, and we will not forget. And I hope as people also, we will not forget, you know, because the government will often only care about what people care about, right? What the electorate cares about. And if the electorate also says, well, we do care about this, actually, then, you know, it'll ensure the media, you know, the media also must not forget it, you know, just when we're outside of the pandemic, you know, suddenly you have no reporting on health news until another big outbreak comes along. So I think it's for all of us. It's for all of us as a society to keep highlighting this issue and to keep saying that, look, we need more investment here. It's not going to work like this. So I think that's on that front. In terms of the end of the epidemic, that's really, you know, that's a huge question. I wish any of us had the answer. You know, forget Niti Aayog. I think nobody would have the answer to that question. But I would just say that, you know, even when the vaccine comes, I don't think we can assume that it's the end of the epidemic. You know, because the vaccine, A, will probably not be, you know, something which is 100% sort of a solution. So we'll need to probably continue following, you know, some of these measures will continue, I think, certainly into next year, but perhaps even beyond. And if COVID does become what we say endemic, you know, and I mean, in that sense that it stays, you know, it goes away, it comes back, it goes away, it comes back, a bit like influenza. If it becomes like that, then of course, you know, we have to continue with a lot of these measures, which, by the way, might not be such a bad thing, because hand washing, as I said, you should always wash your hands. It's not a bad thing. It does not matter whether there is COVID or not. In public places, you need to always be conscious that, you know, you can spread diseases to others. It's not just about you. You might be healthy and well, but you might end up spreading a disease to someone who then, you know, goes on to lose his or her life. So we'll have to bring in that consciousness forever, and something that will have to stay with us forever. So yes, I think I don't see like any one sort of firm end date to this, but this will of course go down perhaps in intensity over time. The vaccine, if it comes in, will help us, but we'll have to keep up our sort of measures of you know, sort of protecting ourselves and others around us from this.
We have a question from Chirayu, sir. Overall, India still has a larger population in rural areas compared to urban areas. And in urban areas, there are metro cities, tier 2, tier 3 cities, and then smaller towns and villages. Is there any data or even a sense as to which level of urban bodies were better able to reduce the cases and minimize deaths? Is there any pattern?
You know, I'll have to really look at, we do have data. We do have data for all of these. As I said, we track these separately. in terms of your large metros, your tier 2, tier 3, and then the more rural districts. So we actually track all the districts in the country, and we've divided them into these sort of broad categories. And also population-wise, we've divided them. Because, you know, it's not fair to compare a smaller one with a very large, you know, densely populated city like a Mumbai. So we have done that, but I'll have to see in terms of response, if we can say for certainty if some have done better or, you know, others have not. But I think in general, you know, where we've had very proactive sort of local governments, and we've had your district magistrates, collectors working proactively with others, in general, I think we can say that we have seen much better outcomes over there, you know. So use of the police very strategically, because of course you don't want to get heavy-handed, you don't want to be beating up people, and you know you don't want to become like that. But you can use the police strategically. You can use other resources, volunteers. So we've seen some very good examples of, you know, when an urban sort of local government system is empowered, and multiple sort of officials are coming together. And implementing a sort of cohesive response, actually the outcomes are so much better than, you know, when you have a slightly loose sort of governance system, or you don't have a very integrated sort of coordination between the different sort of streams of work and the officials. So in fact, I think in some of these, you know, where they were proactive urban local bodies, they also used and worked with NGOs very well. They exactly knew how do we use civil society at this time, where do we engage them. You know, some of them use them for, you know, welfare of women, for people with disabilities, right? These are the sections which the government often struggles to reach out to. These are very marginalized, very difficult sort of sections in this situation in particular. So even the use of how do I engage a civil society partner, how do I engage a volunteer, became much more strategic and effective when you had that empowerment, you know, at that sort of local level. So yes, I mean, I can certainly look at which ones I think might have done better or if there's any pattern. But I think these are just some of, because I've been looking at that data sort of every day. So I think these are just sort of top of the mind. I think definitely some of the things I noticed.
Right. Thank you. So Mercy ma'am has another question. When Nipah virus happened, Kerala could contain it. But when having so much investment in public health in China, how come they couldn't contain it? And what's your take on it?
Yeah, so, I mean, of course, Kerala, I think, is so much ahead than still large parts of the country in terms of the basic public health system, right? Basic general public health system. And that's been years, actually, even well before Nipah virus also, they had started investing a lot. They have always, you know, historically, I would say that Kerala has invested a lot in public health and education. Also, of course, they do have a strong social capital, and I think that does make a big difference. You know, you have that as well. So I think that is missing in many parts of the country as well. So I think that gives them an added sort of advantage. And after Nipah virus, they actually institutionalized a lot of the learnings. So actually, the contact tracing model of Kerala was adapted from, you know, SARS and Nipah virus. And, you know, so they actually adapted all of that. And from the Kerala sort of medical college, they came up with their contact tracing model. So in general, I think Kerala is a well-prepared, strong health system. But in this particular case, you know, they have been overwhelmed. And that is what I think COVID shows, that it can overwhelm even the best, you know, and that is why everybody is so vulnerable. So in fact, their fatality rate is still very good, although there are some, you know, now questions on whether they are fully reporting deaths or not. But frankly, that's in every state in India. Every state in India, we can raise this question. I mean, because I look at this data every day, so I myself am questioning it all the time that, you know, I don't know, this graph doesn't look quite right to me. You know, everything is looking very stable here. So actually, I'm, you know, questioning that for almost every state and district. So I think if that's happening in Kerala, then they're certainly not, you know, the only ones, or, you know, where there's underreporting. But in general, they've done very well on the fatality rate side, which I think shows that at least their clinical management experience has paid off well. But I think they got very overwhelmed after Onam. You know, in fact, I was in a discussion with the health minister from Kerala, and she said, you know, we got very overwhelmed after Onam. We had lots of people returning to the state through all those Vande Bharat flights and everything. You know, everyone's returning to Kerala. from all over the world, right? We had a few rallies, you know, we had a few of those political things happening over there as well. So she said, you know, it was a combination of things which suddenly, very quickly, you know, escalated. And now, of course, they are doing their best. They are again trying to use their system to keep the deaths minimum, which I think is a very important thing, because ultimately in COVID, there's no real value in, you know, hiding cases or any of that, right? All you want to do is you want to minimize your deaths. That's really your only overall goal. So I wouldn't worry so much about cases in Kerala, as long as they can keep their deaths low. And that's something they can continue to focus on. I think, but overall, I would say that, I mean, this particular instance, I wouldn't really fault them, because too much happened together at one go. And as I said, if Sweden can be overwhelmed, then Kerala also can be. But overall, the health system is very commendable. And I think we need to at least take away this aspect that they tried to learn. They tried to learn after Nipah virus. They tried to learn after SARS. They tried to learn after every outbreak. And that's really important, you know, because ultimately you can't prevent necessarily 100% any of these things, but you can learn and you can do things better the next time. So I hope that, you know, at least that bit, you know, we will learn from Kerala, and I think they will be able to control this situation, given their experience and, you know, given what they've done in the past.
Definitely. Okay, we have a question from our alumni, Amarendra Bharati. As we talk about the preventive measures in health, we have to after the food we are generally taking as a wholesome for eating or dependent on locally available food. But now in this industrial age, we are eating more and more packaged and processed food that is somehow degrading our society's health. So my question is that, is the government or FSSAI are planning to promote the locally produced food for people rather than suppressing it on the name of globalization or industrialization? Is there any program running or coming up for this?
Yes, I think, yes, nutrition, you know, as I said, huge part and focus of public health. It has to be integrated with public health completely. Of course, on nutrition, a lot of different things are happening. I mean, you would know of the overall program, Poshan Abhiyan, which is there. But at a more precise level in that, we have been looking at promoting the local diets. And in fact, we are actually building a Poshan Atlas, which will map out, you know, all the agroclimatic zones in the country. And what are the local, foods that are grown there, which are the ones which are nutritious. So the idea very much is to now promote, you know, the local diets, because again, there's no one size fits all. There's no point me sitting in Delhi and telling somebody you should eat this, because they might have a very different dietary pattern over there. They might have, very different affordability. So I think the idea is to look at local, local diets and what is the most nutritious, identify that, promote that. There's a huge focus on promoting millets and, you know, dietary diversification is another big focus area, because, you know, we've often been just in our PTS system also just focused on rice and wheat and at most dals, but we have to also look at millets, we have to look at other kinds of nutritious foods. So there is a focus now coming in on that. And of course, also exploring fortification, you know, like, you know, rice fortification, etc., because, you know, still we have huge amounts of malnutrition. Of course, now we are faced with the dual burden of malnutrition. We have undernutrition on one side, and in a lot of cities and even slums, overnutrition, obesity, all that is starting to come up as well. So I think we're kind of faced with a double whammy of a situation over here. So of course, we need to address both those ends of the spectrum in terms of the undernutrition as well as the overnutrition and obesity and all of that. So yes, there are efforts. There are efforts to do that. It has to be scaled up a lot more. And as I said, best results will come when we integrate it with, you know, public health. You know, if nutrition keeps working on its own, again, those results will not come. In fact, now we have tried to integrate agriculture into it as well. Because historically, agriculture has never spoken to nutrition. you know, so the agriculture ministry will not speak to WCT ministry under whom nutrition falls, you know. So it's all, we have all these complexities in government which often don't make a lot of logical sense, because if I'm talking of nutrition, why shouldn't I talk to the person who's working on agriculture? You know, it's just so logical, right? So we are trying to now bring in some of these linkages, you know, as Niti Aayog and under the umbrella of Poshan Abhiyan. So let's see where that goes, but certainly the efforts are on to, you know, promote locally nutritious foods, dietary diversification, make people aware of what are the best nutrition options they have within their cost sort of structure, right? Because a lot of people think that to get good nutrition, you need to be wealthy, but that's actually, you know, not necessarily true. So I think those are the kinds of things that we're trying to look at now.
I think, ma'am, it's safe to say that the habits that the pandemic has brought all of us are good for us only. Like you had mentioned earlier, washing hands and having nutritious food is something that is good for us, and it's doing more good than bad. We have another question from Nimit sir. Considering we now anticipate that this is not the last pandemic or disruptive event, what would you recommend build environment professionals and urban management professionals to do in terms of capacity building, that is learning, reading or experiencing, for planning their role in fighting and managing these situations in short term and long term?
I think as I said, there's a huge role now. I think urban you know, people who look at urban planning, urban design, I think there's tremendous opportunities, you know, and to work with the health people, again, bring in that intersection as well, because again, we often end up working in silos, and I think that really diminishes the impact of our work. So I think there's huge opportunity to think about, you know, how our cities can become more resilient. Of course, we cannot 100% prevent anything like this, but just, you know, get more resilient to these, and once an outbreak happens, how do we respond better? I think that's the other part of it, you know, like how do we respond more quickly, more effectively? So now that we've had this experience, what can we really learn from it? I think just having those learnings from a city perspective will be very useful, you know, in terms of what have we learned from a city. You know, how do we A, try to minimize or prevent, and B, once it's happened, how do we try to, you know, control it much better? So I think at an overall level, that's something that I think is a huge opportunity, and to work with the different sectors, as I said, in the city context, to get some of these learnings out and build capacity. I think capacity is a huge issue. You know, because a lot of people, we don't have that capacity. As I said, even a lot of people in the government, policymakers, you know, everybody was learning on the go, right? You know, people were trying to learn while this was happening. So we didn't have that inherent capacity necessarily, right? So I think now going forward, that needs to be built up, given that this is something we might face again. So I think capacity and also the whole systems thinking. I think the system thinking here will be very important. You know, how do I think of a city? How do I think of the entire plan for that city, how it will be structured, you know, where people are living, where people are working, where people are moving from one place to another, the transport, all of that. I think a holistic sort of systems approach to this might be very, very helpful.
Definitely. I think we can take two more questions, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
Great. So we have another question from Kajal Thakkar. Can you throw some light on how has Arogya Setu made a difference in the health system and collecting data?
I mean, you're asking me all the controversial questions. You know, I'm not a politician. No, but, you know, I actually never give the technically sort of politically correct answers. So I'll still say what I exactly feel. And what I exactly feel is that technology is a great enabler, but it's not a substitute. And I think this we miss out so often, you know, so often we miss this out. We get a technology solution and we think, oh, wow, you know, we've like solved it, you know, we've cracked everything. And that's rarely what happens, you know, because what we forget is the human behavior, the human interface, right? I'm the one entering data into that application. Right now, if I don't want to tell anybody I'm COVID positive, what is Arogya Setu going to do, right? Because I have too much stigma, I have too much social stigma. I don't want to tell anybody I am positive. You know, I just want to sit quietly at home, not tell anybody. So technology can't do anything, right? It can't force me to enter something which is true or whatever. So I think that it was something that was developed as a technology solution. And I think it does have some, you know, utilities, and it has helped in some situations to identify some of the hotspots, to, you know, do all of that. I wouldn't say it was completely, you know, not useful or effective, but I think we did miss out on some of the public health aspects to that, you know, and that would have made it much stronger, you know. And I don't think it's true just for Arogya Setu. I think any contact tracing technology in the world, if you're going to just develop it thinking of an app, you know, then it's not going to work. You know, you have to think of it as a holistic solution that, you know, this is part of my contact tracing efforts, but it's not a substitute. It's not a substitute for that volunteer or that police person going door to door, like in Bilwara or in a few other places, right? They continue to go door to door. They continue to ask people, who did you meet? Who were your contacts? So it's not a substitute, you know, it can aid you. It can enable your efforts, but it is not a substitute, and it can alert you to some potential hotspots. And it did, but it's not substitute. It's not 100% foolproof by any stretch of the imagination. So I think it could have been better. It could have yielded better results if we had more of the intersection with public health. I mean, that is really my sort of opinion on this. And I think it's true for any technology. You know, for any technology, we cannot forget the people context. You know, the user of any technology, the beneficiary of any technology is still a human being. And we cannot forget that context.
And we have one question from Gayatri, ma'am. The COVID India portal gives data on districts and states quite exhaustively. But at times, there is a perception that the states are not really giving the correct data. Is this another challenge?
It is. It is. As I said, I myself have doubts often. I myself often question when I see a beautiful epidemic curve shaping up for one of the cities. I it's almost textbook, you know, it's almost textbook-like. So, you know, if there's a pattern of a state or a city consistently reporting 10 cases every day or 10 deaths every day, I am questioning it myself all the time that, you know, this seems too good to be true. So, yes, I think that is a big question. And it actually, again, you know, actually that highlights another big opportunity for us is data management, because I think in health, the data management is just abysmal. You know, I think there's no other better word for it. We have a lot of different systems. You know, you have a system for TB, you have a system for maternal and child health, you have a system for nutrition. Those systems don't talk to each other. They don't integrate. So yes, I think that's also another huge opportunity for us to just make the data system more robust, to make it more integrated, to make it more transparent, and to, you know, make it obvious to every level that why is this data useful? You know, I have met so many people who enter data, but they don't know why they are entering it. You know, they say, I don't know why I'm entering this data, right? And until then, it's not going to work, right? If I'm the ASHA worker, or I'm a nurse, or I'm anybody, I'm a district health official, if I'm entering that data, until I know why it's useful or how it will be used, I'm not going to be doing a very good job, you know, because it's sort of human nature, right? If I don't know, okay, what is the use of something, why should I do it properly? It's another burden on me, right? I mean, I have to do all this work and now you're asking me to enter data also. So I think those are holistic sort of set of issues we need to address. But I think the other thing I would say, especially with diseases and with like an epidemic, we need to have very clear messaging that, look, you know, reporting cases is not a bad thing. You know, I think a lot of people are just under fear. You know, they're under fear that if I show my state has more cases or my district has more cases, there'll be some, you know, consequences for me. My neck is going to roll, right? And then nobody is going to do it. So I think the messaging needs to come at every level that actually, if you are reporting all cases truthfully, you are doing a very good job because you are probably going to contain the epidemic much better than any other state. So please continue to test, continue to report cases. And yes, somewhere down the line, we have tried to emphasize this messaging, but I feel that it could have come right at the start. And in the future, perhaps, instead of sort of almost ranking states on number of cases, my preference would be to rank states on number of tests, to, you know, do those kind of things, right? So you almost want to encourage people to report. Because in an outbreak, in an epidemic, if I don't know where the infection is, I can't isolate it, I can't treat it. So I should not be penalized, right, in a sense, or I should not feel that I will be penalized if I'm going to report truthfully. So I think that sort of messaging, I think definitely is another lesson from this, that it can be clearer, it can be stronger. And every level, knowing why they are reporting, what it's going to be used for, and then ultimately integrating all of this, you know, making the systems talk to each other. And there are efforts now under Ayushman Bharat with health and wellness centers, etc. There are efforts to try and integrate it to, you know, digitize, integrate all of that. But I think it's going to be a huge task for a country like us. And we've had all these legacy, you know, systems which don't talk to each other. So it's going to be a mammoth task, but we have to do it because, you know, data, without good data, you know, your whole evidence-based policy making goes for a toss. You know, like a lot of times when I question the data, I say, you know, what projections should I make? I don't even trust the data. You know, so it's a genuine bottleneck. And I think we need to take people along with us in this rather than alienating people, rather than saying, oh, you're reporting too many cases, you know, that's not good for you. So we need to sort of prevent this sort of message going up, because then otherwise people will keep hiding and keep feeling the need to hide. So I think that message that, look, this is a public health emergency. It's a natural situation. It's nothing to blame you for, you know. So you should report what you see. You know, you should not feel the need to hide things. So I think, yeah, that messaging also needs to be very clear and be at every level, you know, right at the top, but then sort of percolate down to every single level, right down to the health, bottom of the health system.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Before we move on, I think I would just like to ask one last question. That is, what according to you, in the sense of urban management, and what we as future urban managers should look out for?
Can you just repeat the first part? Because I lost your voice there.
Am I audible now?
Yeah. If you can just repeat the first part of your question.
I was saying before we wrap the question answer session, I would just like to ask, what according to you would be the new normal, and what should we as future urban managers look out for in this situation?
Yeah, I think new normal will be, you know, as I said, this is here to stay with us for a while. Could be a very long time, but this is not the only thing. You know, we are constantly faced with these sort of situations. So in the new normal, you know, we really need to push the accelerator on terms of public health. There's no other sort of really answer to this. I keep repeating it, but I feel I need to repeat it because people don't, you know, give enough priority to public health at all. So I think that will have to be done in this new normal. But I think as urban managers, you have tremendous opportunities. I think the opportunities are endless, you know, as I also touched upon, and, you know, some of the faculty members also touched upon, and Mr. Bhatt as well, that it's endless, you know, in terms of right from where you design cities to design infrastructure, to human behavior, to social interactions in cities, to how do you integrate the different, you know, elements of people in, you know, different sectors in cities and bring those together, the governance model. How do you make that more effective to tackle something like this? I think there's just enormous opportunities here. And, you know, in terms of both thinking about how we need to design the systems, in terms of what are the lessons we've learned, what can we draw upon from other cities, from global experiences, from our own country, you know, Dharavi, wherever else, even in this pandemic, we've learned so much, you know, we learned so much. Bhilwara, so many districts, you know, that did a very, very good job. What did they do right? You know, what did they do right? What can we learn? How do we scale it up? So I think you have like tremendous opportunities in research, in capacity building, in getting those lessons out and designing the models, as I said, designing the system, you know, because we haven't really thought of our cities in this way at all. So I think all of that, you know, and bringing in the intersections of different sectors, as be it gender, be it nutrition, be it sanitation, water, whatever, you know, might be of particular interest to you, sort of bringing all that together. I think it's been a very unfortunate thing, but as I said, it's given us huge opportunities. And I think that might be the best way to look at it for the future, that how do we use these opportunities to really, you know, build much better cities for ourselves.
Thank you so much, ma'am. On behalf of all the students and faculty, I would like to extend a warm gratitude to Srimati Urvashi Prasad for joining us today. Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking out time from your busy schedule to spend this afternoon with us and expand our horizons and knowledge on topics related to COVID management. I sincerely thank you on behalf of the entire family of Faculty of Management for educating us on COVID management insights, which are extremely helpful considering the present times and in the times to come. Once again, thank you so much for joining us at CEPT University.
Thank you so much. It was a real pleasure to be here, and I love the questions. I loved, you know, all the interaction, and I hope we can, you know, sort of keep up this engagement. We'll have so many other things to talk about in the future as well. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Urvashi. Thank you
thank
for coming
over. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.